Hey guys, welcome to the Swap Moto Live Show presented by OGIO Powersports and FMF Racing. I'm Don Maeda and I'm super excited to have Monster Energy Star Racing Yamaha's Dylan Ferrandis on the set with me. So, buddy, thank you for coming on. I know it was, I asked you a few times, but it worked out. Like, we're, because of the COVID, we're filming here at our office in Lake Elsinore. I guess it's just down the street from your house.
Yeah, exactly. Like, it's lucky for you that now it's in Lake Elsinore. For sure, the old office was a little far from me, and the schedule never easy to find the time, but yeah, now here I am.
Cool. I wanted to get you on right after the championship, but things didn't work out. You went to, was it Bora Bora?
Yeah, French Polynesia.
Like, your just, Instagram was, it made me so jealous. It looked beautiful.
Mine or my wife?
Both.
Yeah, because me, I'm not really sharing a lot of stuff.
But anyway, congratulations on an incredible year.
Yeah.
Two championships for you.
Thank you very much.
Which of the titles was harder to win and more satisfying?
There is no easy title. I think that they're all really hard. Now, with one year later, I almost feel like the first one was maybe the easier because I didn't expecting it, and I just tried the best I can, and it works. The second Supercross title this year was just hard, really hard, and especially the last round, having to go LCQ and just an early day. So it emotionally was really hard, more harder than the first one, because of to deal with the red plate, to deal with the pressure of the championship, that was really hard to do. And the outdoors is outdoor championship this year might be the one of the easiest of my three championship, but at the same time, like red belt, when I had to race with a shoulder pain shoulder, and also the last round when my teammate Justin Cooper blew up his engine second moto, like, and I didn't have enough points. Like, if I didn't start the moto and G-Mart win, I didn't have enough points to win championship. So that was a lot of pressure. But yeah, at the end of the day, was a pretty easy day. So I think the motocross championship was the easier
one. Coming into the outdoor season, everybody just was like, oh, Dylan, he'll win, right? You're the heavy favorite. Was there pressure because everyone is expecting you to win easily?
No, absolutely not. First, I think because I don't really look at what people say. So I was just in my zone and not really take attention of what people say. And last year, 2019, I get smoked by AC on the outdoors, and it just burned me inside for the whole winter, for so many months, so many days at the track, where I was so sad to miss that title, because it's not really often in your life that you can play a title, like you can win a title. When you have the chance to do it, you must be, I mean, that's your life. You just dedicate 100% to that. And I just missed the title because after the Supercross, I was so happy to win that I couldn't just find the motivation to go out and race like I wanted to win. So I just, I was there to win, but not as bad as him, because obviously he lose the Supercross championship. And I mean, he was so devastated after that he just wanted to win everything. So I think he have this fire in him that I didn't have. And so this year, 2020, like, I won the Supercross. I say, okay, give me 2 days. I say to everybody, my trainer, my team, give me 2 days. I just rest. I enjoy a little bit. We went on the way home to Salt Lake. We stopped at Vegas, spend some money, do some cool stuff. And like on the third day after Salt Lake, back to the track, dedicated and no rest, just practice, training, workout. And I arrive first round of the outdoor, just ready, 100% ready. And everything was just perfect until I crashed at Red Bull and hurt my shoulder. But other than that, I mean, I was just so focused and so dedicated to win this championship that nothing else mattered for me than that.
Yeah. How serious was the injury at Red Bull?
So, I can't remember the exact word, but nothing crazy. Like, nothing, I don't dislocate my shoulder. Nothing was bad. But I just have the constant pain, and actually to remember I can't remember the name inside the
separated?
Shoulder.
Separated?
Yeah, I have this. Yeah,
separated.
I have this. So it's not, we made X-ray and everything, scan and everything, and yeah, no big damage because I had a dislocated shoulder a few years ago, and I had to get surgery, so we were scared about breaking the surgery or whatever, and no damage, just that thing separated. There is one more word I don't remember, and yeah, just the doctor just said, yeah, it's gonna be painful for 4 months or 3 months, and no, just a little bit. A lack of strength. Mm-hmm. The muscle was really, really tired, kind of. So just had to deal with that. But mainly was more the pain that was a problem. I couldn't really lift above this. So obviously the handlebar is there, so that was enough to ride. But yeah, it was just painful.
How many races did it affect you?
I started to feel better after Milwaukee for. Florida run was much better, but I think the two Red Bull race really painful, and even Millville, like I couldn't still really lift anything or put my arm higher than this. So, it's part of the job. We all have small injury that we don't really talk about.
Yeah.
We all the same. Every racer, we all the same.
Okay, you looked really relaxed at Fox Raceway at the finale. On the starting line, before the second moto, I heard you talking to Jet Lawrence, and you said, "Hey, how does it feel to win?" You know, I thought that was cool that you asked him that. But when Justin's bike, wouldn't run, you said obviously that makes you scared, right? Because you think, "Oh, same team, everything." Yeah. What went through your head on the starting line, and when you were racing the last moto, were you just listening to everything in your engine? And
so there is multiple things. The first is that while I live in Supercross at Salt Lake, the last run, crashing in the heat, having to go to the LCQ, and the main event being on a way far outside, was so stressful. And even, racing against Austin Faulkner he's not a guy that you can easily beat. Like, he's really a strong rider, a really fast rider. So, and the race before, he pushed me out of the track, which I also did. But so I knew it's going to be hard to fight him in the last round. He's gonna do everything he can to beat me or to make me crash if he had to win the championship. So it was really, really stressful. And on the other side, the last one of the motocross championship was so much easier because less pressure. I know Jim Hart he's a badass rider, but it's not really Austin Faulkner that can really. I feel like Faulkner is a bigger treat than Jim Hart, especially in Supercross. So I was just more relaxed because of that. Less pressure, more point gap in championship, and I knew also I had the speed to beat everyone. So it's kind of easier that compared to Supercross, where Faulkner we were pretty much on same level most of the season, and he also beat me the one round before the end. So. That's why I was more relaxed. And Jet, I know Jet Lawrence from the Europe. We raced in the same team when I was at Kawasaki Factory racing the MX2. And he was there with his brother. Obviously, I was more speaking with his brother because Jet at this moment was really young. So I kind of knew the Lawrence family for a long time now. Yeah. And so it was funny to fight with him this season and to see him win a race. Like, I was really proud for him. And I told him, how is it? Because, it's the last race. Like, there is not much. I had the championship, but all the other guys don't play championships. They're kind of relaxed. So, it's always a good time to have some fun and to relax a little bit the nerve. That was funny. But for sure, when I see Justin's bike not ready, I was like, okay, it's not fun anymore. I pushed harder during the moto, but like five laps before the end, I just
cruise at home.
Yeah, cruise and save the engine. Even if we saw after the race that staying.
Yeah, I wouldn't blow up.
Yeah, never blew up. So I could push more, but I just enjoyed my last five laps on the 250 of my 250 career, and that was good time.
Awesome. Hey, we're gonna take a quick break to hear from our sponsors, We'll be back for more with Dylan Ferrandis. Hey guys, welcome back to the SWAT Moto Live Show presented by OGIO Powersports and FMF Racing. Here with three-time 250 champ, Dylan Ferrandis. Okay, we just cut before commercials. We were talking about the motor not blowing up. Chase and I were in the pits watching the guys holding the thing wide open, and I was actually kind of scared, like, dude, because, you know, you see motors blow up where the cases break and everything. But the thing that scared me the most was, do you remember when you had somebody rev it and you put your face by the pipe and poured the beer?
Yeah.
I just kept thinking about, like, he's going to blow his eyeball out of his head or something, you know?
Yeah, but when, at this moment, you don't really think about nothing else than just enjoy this moment, because it's not really often that it's happened in life. So I don't, for sure.
Yeah.
We did some stupid thing, but yeah, we're lucky and no problem. We had no problem, but yeah. We were all surprised that the bike never blew up, because we really tried to do that.
And yeah, you need to drain the oil.
Yeah. So it's funny because, yeah, that's really, almost become a tradition. Like, now after when every rider win a championship, they just try to blow up the engine, and it never happens. Crazy. Yeah. Those bikes are so strong, it's unbelievable.
I was laughing because, like, you don't see DV that happy very often. He's kind of a grumpy guy. But he was pretty happy. So you went to Bora Bora afterwards, right? And that is, How were you able to travel? Is it because you have a French passport, or?
No. To go there, everybody can go, but to come back in the US at this moment, you need either the US passport or the green card or visa. And so.
So you can go, anyone can go vacation there?
Yeah. Oh. I mean, there was American people, yeah.
Oh, man. It looked amazing.
Yeah.
What did you do there every day? Just lay in the sand?
First three, four days, just resting, because my body was really tired and I was tired, just resting and drinking and eating everything I want. And yeah. We like to snorkeling a lot. So obviously, that's the best place in the world to do snorkeling. So did that all day, and yeah, just enjoyed the real, like, I mean, we didn't really made anything crazy. It was just holiday, like for normal people, you know, just resting and enjoying the weather and the place, and that's all.
Okay, when you came back, was it right back into the routine, like training and testing?
So yeah, we had planned to, as soon as I came back, to start really early the 450 preparation, because there is a lot of work, and unlucky I got the COVID. I don't know if I get it on the way back there, I mean in the US or in French Polynesia, but yeah, we came back and I trained, I think, two times. I do two practice, and the second day, at the end of the day, I was like feeling weird in the taste in me, and feeling retired and weird feeling. And so the next day, when I wake up, I was just sick, I kind of flu, yeah.
Yeah.
And so I went to do a test, rapid test, and I was positive for the COVID.
Oh, so you had it.
Yeah. So yeah, after that, we just say, okay. I mean, I say to everyone, I ask everyone to get tested, because obviously I saw people the early day. No one was positive. I was the only one. And even my wife, we tested the same day as me. She was negative, which was really weird. And so, yeah, to drink 10 days. 10 days I was kind of a little flu. Honestly, nothing bad. Just, yeah, a little tired. Just don't want to do anything than resting.
Yeah.
But some day I did some workout, some day not. And yeah, just I lost the taste and the smell, and I still today don't have it, which is more than a month or maybe 6 weeks, I don't know, which is really unbelievable. Like, I had no taste at all. Like, you can put me anything to my nose, like, I can't smell.
Really?
It's unbelievable. And so I'm really sad, because, I mean, obviously, my wife, she cook every day for us, and I can't taste anything. And if I drink, like, beer or wine, I cannot feel, like, it's unbelievable. It's so weird. And but yeah, just 10 days of being a little sick, we wait 14 days to be, I mean, to respect the rules, kind of. And after 10 days was good, 3 days of working out, trying to sweat and get back to the training. And now, I mean, I other than smell and taste, no problem for me for that. My wife, so she got it like kind of 2-3 days after me, and was really different. She was just more tired and like sore every day, and it took a little bit longer also to feel better, but same, like nothing crazy.
Wow.
That thing is weird.
Okay, so, you know, with the shutdown in the US and, you know, Supercross stopped and everything, I think if you're like most of us here at Saltwater Live, we're like, oh God, you know, it's because I believe I had it in February. After the Oakland Supercross, I got really sick with a fever and a cough. But so now then you caught it after all this stuff. What is your thoughts about the, you know, the shutdown and all that stuff? Do you think it's justified, or was it like a reaction?
I don't know. I don't think I'm the good one to answer, because I don't watch TV. I don't watch the news. We don't have TV. I mean, we have a TV at home, but it's only for play Call of Duty and watching Netflix. But other than that, I have no American or French TV. I don't follow the news. I'm off the social media, so I really cannot give an answer to that. The only thing I know is if the authority said to put the mask, I will put the mask. If they say to stay home, I'm gonna stay home. I'm just gonna follow the authority, obviously.
Yeah.
And I have it. I can. I mean, I personally experienced it, and I feel it wasn't that bad. I had flu before last year, last winter, 2018, going to 2019. I had really, really bad flu twice, which was really weird, because I couldn't get. I mean, it's. Was really, I couldn't train, couldn't do anything for weeks, so that was really bad and worse than the COVID. So I don't know, I am not the good one to answer about this this sensitive subject.
You touched a little bit about when you're on vacation, you ate whatever you wanted and this and that, but are you pretty regimented, like pretty serious, always eating and training?
Oh yeah,
always, right? Like, that's what I hear, is you're 100% here in the US to race.
Yeah, for sure. I'm really dedicated to the work, and I do every day Monday to Sunday, every day of every week. Mm-hmm. Only that few days that we are in vacation. Other than that, I'm just doing everything I can to get better physically, mentally, on the bike. I just do everything. So yeah, for sure. And in 250, I think it's important to not being too heavy, to not mm-hmm. being too fat, I mean, too heavy. Mm-hmm. And so I was really doing all my 250 career, I always be careful to always stay at the limit of my weight.
Yeah.
Sometimes I get tired a little bit because I didn't probably hit enough. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I mean, I always did everything I can, and I think the results show that it pay off. But now for sure, being 450, I can hit what I want, and that's so cool. Like, I try to get weight, but I can't. I don't know why.
Do you have to train differently now because you're on a 450, bigger bike, more strength
no,
needed?
No, honestly, no. We stick to the program with DV. What is weird is that riding in 450, especially in Supercross, Motocross, kind of the same, but in Supercross with the 450, I get much less tired than with the 250. Mm-hmm. Almost like in 250, I was always trying to be at the maximum and to really get the maximum of the power of the bike. Mm-hmm. And that kind of make me tired more. And in a 450, like it's unbelievable. In Supercross, I'm easier, like I can ride much longer. I do the last 4 weeks of training. We did the time of the bike in Supercross was much higher every training than what I did every time on the 250 the last four seasons. So yeah, just more efficient, and that's really, really cool. And but other than that, we stick to the program, same thing. The base technique and doing whoops correctly, the rhythm correctly, try to set up the bike also every day with the team. We improve a lot on that, and still, same thing. I think that's today we were at the track, and we kind of made a track completely different than normal track. We took some place, some track back mm-hmm. backward, and do some transfer during the moto. So that's what we used to do before, and we're still mm-hmm. doing it.
Is it been easy to set up the 450 to your liking? Is it easier or harder to set up a 450?
Easier or harder, I don't know. But the team make at the end of the outdoor season, and when I was in holidays, they did a lot of testing with Willan and mm-hmm. also Colt Nichols. They both ride on the 450 and rode on the 450 at this time. And so they really helped the team to understand the bike and start to do some testing with them. And honestly, when my first day on the 450, I was feeling great, like the mm-hmm. bike, I was surprised how good it was, and yeah, the team, they just it's almost like they took the base of the 250, put it on the 450, and just tried to adapt a little mm-hmm. bit, and it works really well. And for sure we are doing testing every time I ride, but we progress every time, we learn a lot every time. And I feel like we are really early in a winter. I mean, we are not really early, obviously, but I feel with the small amount of time we did of mm-hmm. testing, we are
good progress.
Yeah, good progress, and close to be perfect almost. So, mm-hmm. Yeah, really stoked on that. And Kayaba people and Star Racing people, they really do a good job for that.
Nice. How much influence does David Vollmann have on your bike setup? I mean, obviously he watches what the bike is doing. Does he offer a lot of advice to you about that kind of stuff?
Yeah, honestly, a lot. He's more focusing on having the best technique before doing testing. But when I told him, hey, I can't do that because of the bike. So at this moment, he looks more to the bike, and we try to improve. But yeah, we constantly speaking all together with the team, and if DV say, yeah, I think the bike is too stiff here or too soft there or whatever, mm-hmm. I think we all trust him, and we try what he say or what he proposed, and most of the time it works.
Cool. We're going to take one more commercial break, but we'll be back for one more segment with Dylan Ferrandis.
Don't try to be the fastest on the track.
Be the fastest ever. Work harder than everyone else.
Because dedication is everything.
If they say your goals are crazy, be insane.
Be fast. Be the crazy one. Be unstoppable. One goal, one vision.
We put our heads together to both reimagine and lift the bar on what a modern motocross helmet should be. Opt for the highest level of modern technology and energy dispersion with the Fly Racing Formula helmet. Designed for an elevated defense against a wider range of real-world impact scenarios. Globally engineered with the most advanced materials and technologies available. Outfit yourself with proven technology, lightweight performance, and elevated impact management with the Fly Racing Formula helmet.
What's up, guys? It's Brock Tickle. I ride for the JGR Yoshimura Factory Suzuki Racing Team, and I'm stoked to be back at the races. Planning my comeback to racing was cool to see. I have a lot of support behind me to get me here. FXR stepped up and invested in me, and I'm stoked to be part of them. FXR honestly kind of blew me away. All the product is awesome. The pants fit me awesome. The best fitting pant I've ever worn, and everything's sublimated, and it looks good.
It's hard to put our adventures on hold, but now is the perfect time to prepare for their return. Amsoil has your back with fast, free shipping, and ordering has never been easier. Just look up your vehicle, select your product, add an oil change to your cart, and check out. Spend $50 on Amsoil products, and shipping is on us. Order now at amsoil.com.
Welcome back to the Swap Moto Live Show presented by OGIO Powersports and FMF Racing. I'm here with Dylan Ferrandis. Was it your dream to always come to the U.S. or did like things in Europe run out for you? Or was this always your target?
No, it was a dream. 100% a dream. As long as I can remember, when I could understand what was racing, what was Supercross, and watching on TV the retransmission of the US Supercross that was at this time 10 days after the local time.
Yeah.
So as far as I remember, that's what I wanted to do, and I never dreamed to come in the US and be champion. I just dreamed to come first and race at the highest level and be with the guy doing this Supercross. Of course, after racing in Europe and chasing the win, that was my goal. But as long as I can remember, when I was young, the goal was to just race in this crazy stadium full of people and this amazing show and racing this Supercross. That was a really dream.
Has it been everything that you dreamed that it would be to be here?
Oh yeah, much. I mean, It was and it is almost better than in my dream. Like, honestly, that's the best move of my career and even of my life to move here in the US and race here because, when I was young, I just love motocross and supercross and I always watched the video of the pro at the time, like Chad Reed, James Stewart, Carmichael, everything I could watch, the training at home or the training on the factory track in Corona, like I was just dreaming about that, and now I am, and every day when I go to the track it's with a smile, and I really enjoy it because I'm living my dream. So that's the best what a man can do in his life. So no, it's really, I'm really proud to took the decision one day to sign with Star Racing Yamaha and, and to be there. And and of course now with the three championship, life is even better. Yeah. But I have to fight for that, and I never stop chasing that dream. So really, really proud and really happy to be there.
Okay, you came here with your wife, and you guys are here in California. Obviously, you have DV, who's French, but was it scary to move to America and like be kind of all alone?
Before to move, no, we wasn't scared because
exciting.
When we're in Europe, like you watch the TV show, the movie, you're like, oh, America, it's beautiful, like life easy over there, and everybody's so cool, and like California, a surfer guy and everything. But when you move, you realize that it's a big change, and yeah, just being alone was tough. There is so much change compared to Europe, the lifestyle, the time change, the language, the driving style. Everything is different compared to Europe. So we didn't realize before to move that it will be so hard. Mm-hmm. And when we was there, yeah, the first year was tough. We never regret or we never questioned about did we make a good choice, but we knew it will be better with the time. But yeah, when we arrived, it was really, really hard.
Mm-hmm. You know what I noticed? What I noticed this year, the fans, the Dylan Ferrandis fans, right? Like when the Christian Craig thing happened in Anaheim, everybody's boo, giving you a hard time. But you won every single person back through the summer at the Nationals, right? Because every comment on our content or social media, you just see, oh, Ferrandis, he's a beast. You know, he's got this and everything. Was it difficult to deal with all that bullshit earlier in the year? And does it matter to you that people are behind you now? Or is it just you're here to race and you don't pay attention?
Honestly, it was absolutely not difficult. And I almost joke about it because I always expect this to happen to me. Because as a foreign racer, mm-hmm. like, you know, it could happen in your, I mean, especially in America where people are really proud. I mean, I saw it happen with many French riders before, and it will be the same in any other country in the world. When a foreign racer make crash the local racer, like, what do you expect? Like, it's mm-hmm. normal that people gonna be mad. So I really understand it. And was not a problem because, like I said before, I don't really follow I don't look at social media or anything, even the industry people, industry market, I don't look at anything. So that was kind of easy for me to deal with that. Mm-hmm. It hurt me to know that people send really bad words to my wife or to my, mm-hmm. my trainer or my agent. That was kind of really sad, mm-hmm. I felt. But other than that, no. I mean, I deserve that. I feel like I made crash rider for nothing, and the local boy almost. And, yeah. And no, that was a bad move for me. And no, I just feel that I deserve it.
But everybody's behind you now, right? I mean, all the fans you had when you won the title.
I don't know. I don't really look at it, but. Yeah, I mean, they maybe after the incident, I always say, hey, I just wanted to pass him as fast as I can and just go win the race. And I never wanted to make it hurt or anything. Yeah. So that was the truth. And I think when the race after that, when I showed that I was still the same, doing the same thing, trying to be the fastest I can and win, mm-hmm. and that's what I always do. And during the outdoor, the same. Maybe people now they understand more what happened. That I just kind of wanted to do this move too quick and make a bad decision, and that's all. Because that's mm-hmm. what happened. I just didn't wait enough.
Yeah. Okay. Have you talked to Christian Craig? I mean, you guys are teammates now.
Yeah. I mean, the race after. So I think he. Yeah, the race after that at Glendale, I went during the track world. I went to him and I said, I apologize for. I mean, I think my wife, she talked to his wife and she said, hey, we're sorry for that. I mean, and even mm-hmm. Paige, she was fine. She said, hey, we I mean, he know that because he did that before with Martin, I think, one day, or maybe the rider. Yeah, sometimes it's happened, like, if things go so fast, you have a brain fart or whatever, and it happened. And so, yeah, on a track walk at Glendale the next weekend, when nobody kind of watched, no journalist, no one, I went to him and said, hey, dude, I'm sorry. I know you're mad, but yeah, it was just a mistake for me. And unfortunately, you couldn't, if he didn't really, the problem is his handlebar was too bad to go back to racing, and so he had to DNF. That was the worst thing.
Yeah.
And me, obviously, I won the race. So if his handlebar was fine and he could restart and finish, I don't know, P3 or whatever, that would be really good. But yeah, unfortunately, he wasn't able to regain the track. And I say, I'm really sorry for that. I don't really remember if I told that, but I say, if one day you do that to me, I would understand, you know. Yeah. That's part of the game. When, I mean, as a racer, you always remember when someone do a bad move. So no hard feeling, and just say sorry.
Cool. All right, the Star Racing Yamaha team this year with 11 riders, right?
I don't know. I see the rider comes and leave, and I stop counting.
Well, with the amateur guys, there's 11 guys on your team. Oh. Such a massive team now, but I've noticed that sometimes you're not with the team because you and DV train on your own and everything, but you get along with everybody. Is there good chemistry for you?
I want to say yes, because I try to be nice with everybody. There is, we all are the track to do a work. If we do it together or not, same. Like, I just try to be nice and polite, but honestly, we don't really train that much together, because they all have the same trainer, so they all do the same stuff together. Yeah. And we used to do stuff different, and we try to go different track, different day, and we, like this week, I haven't trained with my teammate once this week, which is it's crazy, but yeah, just we're on different schedule. And but yeah, I have every day I'd say hello to everyone. Some the kids, they don't really say hello, you know, they're kind of a little weird.
I mean, for scary. Me,
no, I don't know, but yeah, I try to always bring a good atmosphere, I always been like this, and yeah, I always also seen a lot of riders that say, I don't know, that's maybe a different mentality. I don't know, sometimes they're not really nice, but now I'm used to that.
Okay, the transition to 450 class. What are your expectations for yourself in 21?
Honestly, no really expectation. Like, I will be a rookie. I think I'm the only one. Sexton will be a rookie too, but he did the pro motocross in 450. So I'm going to be the only real rookie. I don't know. I don't want to put the bar too high, because there's no point to do that. Honestly, no goal, no expectation. I'm going to train the hardest I can this winter, and show up the best prepared I can, and do the best I can. And we see at the end of the first round, for sure. I think I'm going to need a few races to figure out the pace, the adversity also, because when you look at the paper, the name on the paper of the 450 championship, at least 10 riders won championship before, so it's unbelievable. And I will be with them, and we never race before in 450 the Supercross championship. So it's it would be stupid to set a goal, because there's no sense to that. My plan is really to do like my first year in the US in 250. Yeah, just doing the best I can first round. If I do 3, 5, 6, 8, we take it, and then the next round the goal is to be
better,
and then do that all year. And it works in 250 for my first year. And I remember my first race, I finished 6th, and wasn't great, but I was stoked for first race, never raced in the US before in championship. Was just happy. And then after that, I think I finished 5 maybe in Toronto, and then I got a top 3 in Daytona, first podium. So I think the I'm gonna do the same for this next season, just take race by race and do the best I can, and that's the most important.
Last question here. You always wear the chest protector, right? And I spoke to some people. I understand that you're very big on safety equipment. Mm-hmm. What are your thoughts about that kind of stuff? I mean, you wear the armor. Like, a lot of guys want to show their jersey and everything, but you've always had a chest protector on.
Yeah, I mean, I like when we do photo shoot, I don't wear chest protector, obviously, because it's cool. Like, riding with just the jersey, it's you're looking good. You have good style, good flow. But yeah, racing, I feel safety is so much important. Like, we see really bad story before, and I think today, I might be 250 champion, but I'm still a fan of the sport. I still love to watch the other rider, and when I see some racer riding with no chest protector, I kind of feel bad because they don't show the good example for the kid. And for sure they're pro, they know what they do, but mistake can happen. And for the next generation, for the kid, like they are gonna do mistake. And I wish people, when they see me wearing chest protector on front and in the back, they say, hey, okay, you can win championship with the chest protectors. There is no problem with that, so they're gonna wear a chest protector. I think it's really important to show the safety for the next generation and the kid. And I wish I could ride without, but I think for the safety, it helps. It's nothing. It's just plastic, and that can protect you from the handlebar in the belly, or if you get land on the back. I mean, there's so many things that can happen during a supercross race that if you have small protection, that can make a difference, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this is kind of a trivial question, but you as a pro racer, you get new gear every race, right? Mm-hmm. And probably in a season, you probably go through 50 jerseys or something, right? How many chest protectors did you use last year?
So I tried to have two chest protectors of all the color available. I try to have two of each, because more for the outdoors, one for Moto 1 and one for Moto 2. This way I don't have to wash it or whatever. But no, I use always the same. I think this year we changed the white protector one or twice. Mm-hmm. They get like, they use, but you don't see it when I race. Like I do the full season with the same chest protector almost, or maybe use two different, but no, honestly, they don't get used fast, and that's cool.
Yeah, cool. Hey, Dylan, thank you for coming on. Really appreciate you spending some time with us today. Guys, make sure you keep your eye on Dylan Ferrandis in 2021, and then like and subscribe and check out swapmotolive.com. Thanks for watching.